of today. I'm representing Arizona State University.
Very nice. It looks like a trident. There's no water near you guys.
What? I know, isn't that weird? It's the sun devil, you know? Hey, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
You know, friendly conversation over a cup of coffee and some loud music. But
yeah,
how are you, Chris?
I'm doing well. How are things in Phoenix? Sunny as always.
Phoenix is sunny and warm and beautiful. In Canada, how's it treating you?
It's sunny and warm and beautiful today.
No.
I know. Miracle.
What the heck? Wow.
Are you in Canada or are you speaking on behalf of Canada? Is that what's going on?
It's both.
Okay.
You know. Yeah, no, I'm in Ottawa, our headquarters.
Oh, right. Well,
yeah.
Cheers.
Here's to the Canadians. America's hat.
Yes, America's hat that we care about, no matter what people say.
We love you. We love Canada.
Yeah.
Hey, Craig Wiggins, good to see you too, my friend.
Good to see you guys.
Thanks for hanging out with us.
Oh, I do it every chance I get.
I appreciate that. Yeah, it's always a good time. Yeah, where you're in D.C., you said, right?
I am. Actually, I'm working out of the home office this morning in somewhere in the metropolitan D.C. area. I was going to try and keep that secret, but I feel like I tell everybody I'm in Alexandria, Virginia, right across the water, right over near Reagan National Airport, where I can see the planes take off and land, which is, you know, good fun. That's nice.
Does Air Force One take off from there?
I don't think so. I don't think they want us to see that happen. Now I have to figure that out. I don't know where that takes off from. I know that Air Force Two takes off from the Naval Observatory because I think they've got a pad over there. But the Naval Observatory is like in the city proper. But more DC trivia that we could talk about some other time. I've got a ton of it.
Another day, another time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we've got a topic for today, Chris. What's our topic today?
I'm sorry, say that again.
I was asking Chris, what's our topic again today?
Oh, yeah. What the hell are we talking
about? I think it's about building bridges or maybe planning city planning.
If only there were some type of person that were skilled in the arts of building things. In a scientific fashion to, you know, erect structures and, you know, and tools such that people can actually get on with the... Oh, wait, we're talking about learning engineering today. Man, it's a good thing. Gosh, man, almost missed it. Yeah.
Jeez, this is pretty cool for me, I will say. All kidding aside, everybody in the chat, first of all, welcome everybody in the chat. Holy smokes, we got a nice big group of folks hanging out with us today. You guys are awesome. I see a whole bunch of very familiar faces. You guys feel free to engage with us. This is totally informal. Say whatever it is you want in the chat. Be nice. Keep it clean, you know, all those ground rules. and we're going to talk about learning engineering, which I am super psyched about. It's whenever something like this starts to happen and percolate, you know, everything always has a beginning. But most of the industry, it's our industry or other industries, when this kind of stuff starts to happen, people don't really know about it until it is like done and starts getting pushed out and promoted. This is one of those things that's really kind of at the early stages still, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I can tell you, well, let me back up a little bit. Well, the organization that I'm working with right now is fairly new. The concept of learning engineering is... Well, I wouldn't say old. I'd say it's probably been around for a couple of years. I think Rohr Saxberg published an article in the Chronicle of Higher Education back in 2015. But if I remember correctly, he had written something on his own personal blog. Just to kind of give you a sense of what I'm talking about, Rohr Saxberg is the chief learning officer, or was the chief learning officer of Kaplan. If you guys are familiar with them.
Yep.
And the problem he came across is this, is that he realized, you were mentioning, you know, building, you know, bridges before, you know, we don't just let anyone build a bridge. Like, you know, your cousin can't just be like, you know what, we need something, we need to cross the water. I got it. I got a truck. I got some lumber. No problem. No, car is going to go over that. If you don't do it right, you know, it's going to fall down. You think, despite, you know, maybe with all the technology that we have and all the education we have that goes into making sure that people are trained correctly or that performance is supported in the proper manner, we don't always, there are two things we don't do, maybe to the best of our ability or in an organized fashion. We don't apply learning science to the pursuit of performance improvement in a uniform and common and standardized fashion. And we don't measure the outcomes properly. And we, the third thing, out of two, because I can't count, is that we can't, we don't necessarily always understand how to build things, that would be the bridge, properly, right? So we do with what we can. Now, I think personally, this is a result of us coming into this field, a lot of us coming into the field, kind of to borrow Cami Bean's, you know, term of the accidental designer. You know, we, a lot of us get to a good place because we, you know, because of channels like what we're, you know, what we're on right now, you know, people sharing their information, people going to conferences, people working with peers who know what they're talking about. But it's definitely not direct. I think most instructional designers would tell you that their path to becoming an ID was, you know, it was crooked timber. Let's put it that way.
Yeah.
So, you know, this is something that's been standing out. You probably know people like, you know, people who work at companies like Rusty Software or Yet Analytics or, you know, any of the people or, you know, or Domino or, you know, Articulate, you know, et cetera, like people who work to create systems whereby people can create learning or create performance support tools, e-learning, training, et cetera. The mix of skills that they have are things that are not, it's not really well documented. So I'm going to pause in case anybody has any questions before I launch into talking about what I'm doing.
I'll throw in a couple of observations. A very astute friend of mine once said that our business is you learn basically by an apprenticeship model.
You know,
similar to the accidental, but you come in to do something. Maybe you were the expert in the software tool. So now that, because you know everything, you're going to make you the trainer or the, or, you know, or whatever sort of thing. Coming from a context of subject knowledge. And then you look around and you do the thing that the person, your boss has been doing or whatever. Oh, here's PowerPoints. Here's the, you know, here's what we do.
Yeah.
Here's a whole bunch of things we've made. Just make, you intuitively just end up making more of that in a real way. And very few, it's fairly rare initially that someone would come into this space with actually formal education before doing this job on the whole.
Yeah.
Lots of folks pick it up. Lots of folks will go and do a degree or something once they realize that this is their thing. But that initial piece, plus the model that we've all got is, you know, we all went to school. There was a person standing in front of us telling us
everyone knows everything
in a classroom. And that's the main model that we've all got mentally for how teaching or providing learning or something like that works too. So definitely all kinds of things that we bring in, assumptions, et cetera. And many of those models that we, you know, grew up in or even learned initially are not necessarily effective models. So,
yeah.
So it really is important.
No, I absolutely, I hadn't thought about it that way, that I do agree. You know, I've always talked to people as well about the fact that, we know everybody knows education, which is why teachers don't get any respect because, you know, it's like, I know this work or I did whatever.
I can do that.
Right. It's like, oh, you're teaching, you get summers off, whatever. You just want to, anyway. So that extends to our field as well. You know, people think like, oh, well, I know how best people work. That happens when you are working with your subject matter experts or with your client. Like, they want to like get in there. I think we have like graphic artists are here and we're like probably here in terms of getting disrespect from our clients just because everybody's like, I know how to art. So, I think what also happens, you pointed out something really interesting about people having a formal education. You know, sometimes they have that, but oftentimes they don't, and they turn out fine. But a lot of times people will have formal. I was at a meetup earlier this week with Megan Torrance, and one of the members of the party who was at the table, turns out she's a lawyer. Right. And she was already a lawyer before she got into instructional design. So she's not long into the instructional design world. She's hoovering up as much as she can right now, but she's bringing her sensibilities from the world of law which, by the way, should be a whole, I'm urging her to write an article because it's a whole other thing that I think is like quite interesting looking at it from a legal standpoint, you know, not just compliance or whatever. But anyway, there has been a need for people to have the same kind of rigor that you would have for, you know, engineering software to engineering learning. And I think that's something a lot of us have been poking at for a while. So I'll say this. So back in, 2017, I guess the end of 2017, got together. The IEEE, which you guys are familiar with, they established standards in the industry for software. They're the people who codify the standards for Bluetooth and for Wi-Fi, and for that, you know, they should be lauded. They handle a bunch of array of other things, including the existing technical action group for XAPI, which is ongoing, which is like, yay, finally, we're legit, mom. So they decided, a few people decided in 2017, I think the end, I think December of 2017, by the recommendation of the IEEE SA Standards Board, there was a formal approval for a 24-month activity plan to run from the end of 2017 to December 2019. The group is called IEEE ICICLE, and ICICLE stands for IC Industry Consortium on Learning Engineering. So I feel like we back engineered that so we could say ICICLE, so all of our stuff is ICICLE. It's very image appropriate. So it's comprised of organizations in academia and industry and government, you know, federal and state level. I think the goal that we have is to support the development of learning engineers as a profession. So on one hand, just like, you know, people who are doing the job, because I think, you know, as you alluded, like people are already doing the job. They're kind of wending their way there. This is going to give them some structure, but also the academic discipline, right? Like, what do you need to actually know? You know, and this is not necessarily just about it being in academia, but like, what is the required curriculum for someone who wants to become a learning engineer because that's what they want to do? They're setting out to become that thing, right? Yeah, there we are. Yay. Oh, that's not us. Those are some pretty people. the website, you can, visit. There is obviously the information about the FAQs, et cetera. There's a link down at the bottom of the right there that says SIGS. I want to point your attention there. That is the special interest group. So I'm the vice chair of this group. Shelley Blake Plock of Yet Analytics is the chair. And these groups that are listed underneath here, like AI and adaptive technology, competency frameworks, learning engineering, academic curriculum, data governance and privacy, XAPI and learning analytics, design for learning, et cetera, you know, XR for learning and performance augmentation, that would be cross reality, meaning VR, AR, MR, et cetera. These are the different special interest groups, so different areas that a learning engineer would need to know about. Each of these groups is working on that. So we have a good number of people from around the world who are involved. We're looking for, you know, more people to become involved. But I want to back up a little bit because I don't think I've talked, you know, specifically about what learning engineering is and what a learning engineering does.
Yeah. Let me try to help set the stage a little bit with one particular question that has crossed my mind and that I have not been able to get clarification on, and maybe this will help. So when we're talking about a learning engineer, yes, are we talking about defining a standard for somebody who builds the products and the tools that an instructional designer would then use to do their job? Or are we talking about that job of the instructional designer or e-learning developer changing over time, and this is what we're trying to get ahead of, and a learning engineer is really going to encompass enough understanding to be able to do both?
Really the latter. I wanted to, you know, we were talking, I was like, no, it's definitely the former. But then he got to the end and was like, yeah, no, it's the latter. Yeah. Actually, to be honest, it's both. So okay. It is the things that someone would need to know to be able to build. So we have a lot of people. I'm trying to think of a couple of them. And now, of course, I can't. People that you know in the industry who are famous for, like, you know, building software. A lot of the people who are working to, you know, in the world of creating a learning record store, for example, like those guys, largely guys, are they have been learning engineers, you know, kind of after the fact, right? They're involved in creating software, but they have a grounding in learning science and learning theory. So they're not just out there just building software. Their products are informed by their principles, and they're actually, you know, using the scientific method to, you know, they're doing trials and comparisons properly. They're applying, you know, like already earned knowledge to be able to figure certain things out or to shape what they're actually trying to do, as opposed to just kind of building something and then hoping that people could use it. At the same time, the job of the instructional designer, and this is actually key, so I'm glad you brought it up, the job of the instructional designer, to a large part, is probably going to change. And the reason that I say this is that, because I have history on my side, right? I think anybody who's been in this industry long enough realizes that, like, you know, if you've been in long enough, you remember when, like, instructional designers were just curriculum mavens, right? I mean, we just worked on creating curriculum, you know, working out, you know, actively following ADDIE or, you know, whatever framework, you know, doing analysis, you know, getting into storyboards or, you know, working with content, working with SMEs, and actually, which is still the root of what we do. The problem is we're largely responsible in a lot of organizations, not just for the design of content. We're also, you know, I take myself right now. I'm the LD manager for the company that I work for. So that's my title, but, like, you know, right now I'm doing a lot of things. So I'm doing development. I'm doing, you know, design of curriculums. I'm doing design of presentations. You know, I'm creating a learning ecosystem component, you know, list of things that I actually want to, like, put together. And, like, I'm designing how the data flows would work. Like, so there are a bunch of different, like, disciplines that I'm actually pulling from to do that. So, you know, I don't even think I'm the best example of this, but I think a lot of us out there, especially freelancers, end up kind of doing it all. And when we say all is getting bigger all the time. What all was, like, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, you remember, like, yeah. You know, it was like, all right, you know, we cut the line, you know, we cut the line, or we the line is drawn at offering tools, right? You know, okay, well, we'll make our own courses, but we're going to keep it in this box. And, like, man, we're not going to, you know, if you want JavaScript, well, you're going to have to talk to the developer. Well, okay, now that's not necessarily the case. A lot of instructional designers are working with their offering tools such that they have had to learn JavaScript specifically to extend the capabilities of that stuff. Offering tool vendors have responded in kind to that and actually, you know, created things that enable the use of JavaScript and actually built that in. The explosion of the Experience API on the scene, that changed, I mean, in my opinion, that changes forever, you know, the responsibilities of someone who calls himself an instructional designer. Unless they're fortunate enough to be working, you know, in a silo, or they have kind of, like, their own, not silo, but they have their own, like, base where they're actually doing things, they are going to have to extend their capabilities out. Even if they have a developer or, you know, people who are working to drum up content or people who are working to, you know, they have technical writers and things like that, they still need to understand a bit more than they would normally do in order to properly communicate with those folks. So, you know, branching out into tools, understanding how to write, you know, narration correctly, understanding how to work, you know, edit audio, edit video, you know, understanding how to work with XML, understanding what JSON is. Yeah, like, you know, and then how those things actually affect and are influenced by trends in industry, trends in academia, you know, and then if you're responsible for the future growth of your organization, you know, plotting out a roadmap of how you'll grow and how you'll future-proof your systems, that is a far cry from just worrying about curriculum and worrying about individual courses and kind of throwing things over the fence or just, you know, job aids or, you know, just, you know, style sheet or smile sheets at the end of classes.
You've got a lot of really, really experienced people heading yeah. those special interest groups. I recognize a handful of those names.
Yeah.
On there. And those folks have a lot of experience in the industry. And as I go through and I look at all the special interest groups, and to Lita's point too, I mean, we look at, and all those things that you just mentioned, that's a lot of stuff for somebody to come across. Have you guys met with any resistance yet from people saying, I don't think we should be, you know, what's the phrase everybody uses? Expert of everything, master of none,
like a master of Jack of all trades, master of none.
There you go. Yeah, exactly.
So to be honest, like the dystopian future of like having to know everything that I've just outlined is, in my opinion alone, I'm not going to saddle Icicle with this, is a historical, it's based on at least my take on history in the industry. Like you're going to have to know more and do more. But really, I think what we're trying to do in Icicle is actually, you know, isolate, and this kind of goes counter to what I'm saying, but isolate, you know, hey, this is a thing. One, this is a thing. A learning engineer is a thing. Two, this is what you have to know to be able to do that. What we're hoping, what I'm hoping in particular, you know, I work in a world where, you know, we do federal government contracting, right? So we work a lot with the federal government and the DoD, at least the company that I work for. When bids go out for like positions for people to handle training, it would be really helpful if, you know, there was an actual description for a learning engineer and not like, you know, training person or, you know, whatever, you know, whatever people listed are listed now. Sometimes we're listed as instructional designers, but the things that they need over time actually, you know, increase. So in reality, what we want to do is define that thing so that in the future, you know, you may still be saddled as an instructional designer to do all these things. If you are, you'll have a ton of guidelines on how to do things correctly or, you know, how to actually pursue things. But if you're, you know, if you're have a learning engineer or you want to be a learning engineer, you'll, this is how you get there. And this is what you should do when you're actually doing that. I feel like I've kind of skipped over a step and I need to kind of talk about like what a learning engineer is. Cause I feel like that's actually pretty important.
Let's do that.
Okay. So we are still figuring that out. We're still figuring, based on what I was talking about, we know what one is supposed to do to a large extent. We're sort of figuring that out right now. I've got a bunch of definitions at hand right now, but I'd probably say the one that makes the most sense is that, learning engineering is a systematic and iterative application of evidence-based principles and methods from the learning sciences to better understand and support learners in learning. So you'll notice in that definition, there's nothing about building things, right? So that I think someone earlier was talking about learning technologists as, you know, is a proper term. Possibly, but really it's about bringing the science, you know, learning theory and learning sciences to bear. Now, that, in, you know, may include or inform, you know, building things and actually, you know, in particular building software, crafting software, but it's really, you know, having learning engineers who apply scientific knowledge of how people learn to design and build systems that support learners and improve learning. And that latter definition, the one I just said right now, which includes building and actually includes the application of scientific knowledge about learning, that's my favorite definition. So a number of competencies or, you know, things that a learning engineer would need to do, you know, like we are trying to make sure that they understand, you know, data privacy and actually how to ensure that. We want to make sure that they understand how to work with things like the Experience API, how they, you know, that they understand how to design for and how to use virtual reality, augmented reality. We want to make sure that they understand learning sciences themselves, you know, in an organized manner. And the special interest group that is working on the academic curriculum, they're focused on that. And I'm super excited about that.
Is it possible that a learning engineer could be at some point sort of the non-academic version of the PhD in our industry? So maybe we still have instructional designers that do instructional design, and then maybe the next level up is instructional designer / developer because they've developed some technical skills. And then if you really want to, you know, be seen at the top of your game, you become a learning engineer.
That is ideally that's what I'd like to see. And I know that in your, I think your description of this, you talked about a standard, and I remember looking at that going like, I don't know if I really like that, because, you know, while the IEEE does deal in standards, that's one of the directions that XAPI is heading under IEEE, you know, it's not really a standard. But on the other hand, I think we are working towards possibly some sort of, we're definitely working towards some sort of designation. I think eventually it could be academically, like this, you know, this acronym at the end of somebody's name could indicate that they're a learning engineer, and the esteem with which that some, you know, someone would be regarded. Yeah, I think it would be in it could potentially be in the direction of PhD. In fact, better than PhD, and I'm saying, don't quote me on this, better than PhD, because a lot of times when you see someone who has a PhD, there is a lot of respect accorded. You know, they've done, you know, they have done successfully done research and they've added to the body of knowledge in the subject matter area, right? But it's a particular subject matter area, and you know that they have done research and they're familiar with, you know, how that works, and they'll probably continue to do that. But you don't know about their, you know, their everyday real world applicative skills, you know, whether they've actually done that. I feel like a lot of people that will be involved in, and a lot of the people, I would say almost all of the people who are involved in learning engineering right now, they come from different parts, you know, industry, government, academia. But they are all, I think the thing they have in common is they get their hands dirty, right? And because they've had to do that to get where they are right now, because there's no other way to do it, because we don't have a path whereby you could have an ivory tower to the position of being a learning engineer, I'd say.
I think it would be, the comparison to the PhD is actually, I'm finding it a little bit off-putting, because it suggests that you have to have a huge investment ahead of time, in order to be qualified to do a role. And I think when we look at the sheer, you know, spectrum of all the things that you've talked about, whether that's knowledge of technical things like JSON and programming things, XAPI, through to how to actually just simply write good copy, you know, that people will learn from, as opposed to boring and dull copy. That's such a spectrum of skills and such a diverse range of things that my initial reaction right now is, well, there's going to be only a very rare number of people who could actually demonstrate that they have all of those skills. And it just feels a little bit maybe like carts and horses. And I'm very much in the camp of folks need to know, science-based and you know, get a formal education in order to improve, you know, what we do. But it also, at the same time, the whole sheer list of things that this potential learning engineer encompasses, I think, almost sounds daunting, actually.
Oh, yeah. Well, I would say this. Currently, there's not, while we're trying to fashion an academic curriculum and working with industry to figure out, like, how this would work, you know, look in a professional situation, et cetera, this is something that someone could take on their own, right? In fact, we encourage that. We want people, this is going to be the groundwork, and it's very early days still. But we want to lay the blueprint for how people should actually pursue the different things that they have to when they have to. So it's more about guiding them so they're doing things in the proper way. The other thing is, I don't think, I think you're correct. I think that it could be daunting, but I think it already is kind of daunting. I think one of the things we're saying here is that you don't necessarily have to do all of these things to be considered a learning engineer. I think that, again, the main thing that you have to do is, you know, try to apply learning science, you know, to be able to turn out performance support or performance improvement solutions that, you know, are, again, based in science, not based in, like, learning styles or, you know, et cetera.
Well, I think a good analogy is the is building a house or building a physical structure of some sort, right? There's architects, there's engineers, there's contractors, there's consultants, there's a whole collection of people that it takes to put this stuff together. There's draftsmen, right? You can be a learning engineer, and maybe at one point in your career, you learned how to draw the drafts and do all that stuff. But as you go along, you get other people to do that, and it's no longer sort of your job. You're the one who understands the broader picture, the broader scope. And I guess PhD was the only thing that I could equate sort of that leveling up to, but I by no means meant academia, because I saw Marco jump in. I don't think it should. I mean, it would probably end up at some point being part of the academic structure, but seems to me like it would be, there's too many different things involved in it. And to his point, not everybody is fit to go into that academic road. And I would hope that this might be an interesting way for us to maybe certify people at that higher level outside of the academic system not do the PhD thing.
So again, I'm probably going to have to answer this when I go to our steering committee meeting later. But if you're asking me, yes, that's the way that it should go. I want to back up real quick and kind of talk about like what we're trying to do, and that'll kind of tie into what you said. Okay. So you know, we have a couple goals. You know, ICICLE got together to do a couple things. So in its charter, we have to get these things done by December 2019. So one, host an international conference on learning engineering. That's going to happen next year. I believe it's going to be happening in Virginia. You can go to the website for more information about that, or you know, come to one of our meetings and talk your ear off about it. We will create a white paper on learning engineering and the proceedings of that conference. And then we'll have code repositories for applied research in learning engineering across the special interest groups you're talking about. Among all that stuff, I think one of the things we'll be talking about at, you know, either at the conference or leading up to the conference will be, you know, how will we certify people? Like, do we start certifying people? You know, how should companies, you know, in the industry respond to this sort of thing and try and set things up, or what should they follow? While we have a lot of people from academia, who are part of ICICLE right now, I would say that everyone is committed to making sure this is something that, you know, is accessible, you know, out in the world in the same way that engineers oftentimes. I think the, you know, comparing them to software engineers is actually probably a better analogy in this case. I would say that you can go to college to learn how to be a software engineer, but that won't make you a great engineer. Conversely, you don't ever have to go to college to learn how to be a great software engineer. You know, it helps in some ways and it kind of like streamlines certain things, but really it's about doing, having experiences, working in teams, working just, you know, long hours on your own, having varied experiences. And what we're trying to do here is create, you know, by having the conference, creating the white papers, actually, you know, provide some guidance for people who are, you know, whether they're in academia and trying to go through things or not, what they should do. So I think the academic curriculum, for example, I don't think it's necessarily, and this is actually still under development, I don't think these are things that are necessarily going to have to be within the Ivory Tower, per se. It's just what you should read and know, right, to understand certain things, and what you should, maybe courses you should take. Those may be available through, you know, purveyors that are not within academic institutions, you know, to, you know, literature that one needs to have read, and other experiences, like basically setting people up, you know, for success in terms of the knowledge that they're kind of holding or have access to when they're confronting problems.
The tell me a little bit about, you know, the I guess the raison d'etre for this. What, you know, where did in the background, where did it come from? And I guess the thing that I'm thinking about in this context is that, you know, there are certification programs. You know, ATD can, you can do the ATD certifications, etc. Mm-hmm. Is it that there are you know, gaps in what that offers someone? That's being, you know, that the IEEE was trying to, you know, address, or
yeah, I think it's you know, so there are a lot of organizations out there, but I think they, a lot of, necessarily so, because they kind of touch upon, like, think about, man, I don't want to name any conferences in particular, but think about some conferences you go to where, like, they're focusing on everybody, right? So there's a certain point in your career when you go to a conference. Man, I'm never going to get to go to a conference again after I say this, but you go to a conference to meet up with the other people in your industry who, you know, you may attend their talks, and you'll attend talks that are for people, you know, new people as well, because you want to keep learning. But a lot of the best stuff that you get out of the conference is the fact that you're in one place with other people who have had certain experiences and, you know, are there to present stuff. But a lot of the best stuff, I mean, man, yeah, I'm never going to get to a conference again.
You're not the only one who thinks that.
Let me paraphrase, I guess, a little bit to put a spin on the way the structure of many conferences are absolutely perfect for people who are novices or early in their career.
That's what I'm trying to get at.
But as you become more proficient, as you become more experienced, you know, the sessions, etc., you tend to already have experienced those at many aspects of that, but very much what you're also suggesting is that there's still at least a networking value of the other folks who are, you know, at your own level.
Yeah.
And I don't think anybody at a conference organization level would ever say that that's, you know, that's a pejorative description of it. Mm. So I think we got you in the clear there.
Okay. Thank you. I was like, man, I really do want to show up to some things. So I think ICICLE exists because, you know, while there's been an exponential growth in the development of learning tech, right, there hasn't been a lot of support specific to the professional development of the engineers designing and building and deploying the new technologies, for example. So these professionals need they have a particular skill set, and that includes a lot of things we've been talking about, And we believe that it merges engineering and systems thinking and learning science and theories of human development, like kind of across the gamut. ICICLE was made to provide like an actual definition and support to the field and to advocate for the development of the profession and for the academic discipline of learning engineering. Basically, we're trying to get pretty specific about what it is you need to know. We're trying to get very, you know, clear about what it is you need to know, the areas where you need to have some expertise if you want to be able to occupy a certain space, let's say, within the field. And there are different types of learning engineers, although this is, you know, again, this is currently being defined. You know, we're in the process of doing this. So there's the idea of the designer type learning engineer, at least the way that I see it is kind of a master of ceremony for a design group, you know, having enough competency and experience, you know, over you know, certain things to be able to provide advice and guidance to the team about carrying out. So that would be, I think, as you guys were referring to earlier, maybe like a conductor or a, you know, an engineer on a site, as opposed to like a direct architect or, you know, somebody who's actually working in construction, et cetera. And there are different things, but what I want to stress is that, you know, each week or depending on the schedule, each of the special interest groups meets and actually, you know, is working towards their product for the conference that'll be taking place next year. And in the meantime, we're also going to different conferences around the country, and actually, I shouldn't say that, around the world, and talking about learning engineering. I know that my old, I guess, you know, I used to work at the Advanced Distributed Learning Initiative, which is, if you guys know, they're the people who brought us Storm, and technically the people who brought us the Experience API. They are resuming their iFest conference, so that'll be happening August 27th here in Alexandria, Virginia, at ADL headquarters. ICICLE will be having a presentation, you know, at that festival, you know, to talk about learning engineering. In fact, I think Bror Saxberg is going to be there himself. I'm not quite sure, but so that's one of the venues in which we'll be talking about. I know that some people went to, I want to say, the Society for Learning Analytics and Research. They went and they attended. They were members of ICICLE, and they talked a little bit about it. You know, some of our members go around and actually do that. So that it's, you know, we're trying to spread the word. You know, we have evangelists in doing that. Meanwhile, you know, we meet on a monthly basis, like the entire group meets on a monthly basis to talk about, you know, what we're doing, our progress and things like that. I, as the vice chair, spend a lot of time, you know, talking to the individual chairs of the special interest groups and attending meetings when I can to get a sense of what's going on and, you know, what support they need, et cetera. But the call I want to put out, you know, that I've kind of got, I've been trying to get to for a little bit, is that we need more people. We have a ton of people involved right now, but, you know, we're looking to expand our reach. So, you know, we want more people from around the world to weigh in, because this is sort of your chance. I think Brent was absolutely correct. This is at the beginning of things. Like, we started in December of last year, but that's not that long ago. The conference isn't until, I think, spring of next year. So, we have a conference committee in addition to the special interest group. So, you know, if need be, if you're interested in seeing or helping to shape how this works out, you know, by all means, you know, show up to the conference committee meeting. You know, if you're really interested in VR and AR, the XR group is headed by Mark Lee is doing, you know, is really off and running now. The group that's involved with XAPI and learning analytics, like they have. So I'm organizing the special interest groups using Slack, but the XAPI and Learning Analytics special interest group has its own Slack on its own because it has its own subcommittees. It's got speakers every week, and they're sharing, you know, information with, you know, peers. So it's, if nothing else, I think just coming to meetings or, you know, going to the site, you know, going to the individual, you know, repositories for these groups will give you a sense of what they're working on and give you a chance to immerse yourself in discussions that maybe you're not getting at your workplace or maybe you'd like to, you know, ruminate on or think about so that you can actually apply them properly. So I think in some ways it's a really good networking opportunity, but I think it's also, you know, above all, a really good way to, you know, kind of dip yourself into the zeitgeist of progress in a certain area and then how, you know, application and codification of this sort of thing is going to be progressing. So. Yeah, it's good for.
I think it's fantastic, and we got to bug out here. We're oh, going along as we normally have a tendency to do, but I just wanted to, you know, help refine that point a little bit too, and just let people know I've been in this industry for a really long time. Craig has been in the industry for a really long time. As I mentioned earlier, a lot of the other folks that I see leading those special interest groups have been in the industry a really long time. Some of the questions that you all are asking in the chat, I think, point to the fact that it would be great if you would engage with them. And this is the very beginning, and they're looking for input. So if you ever wanted to get involved and watch something like this grow and be a part of it from the very beginning, and quite honestly, in a sort of selfish way, it's a great way to make a name for yourself, and not selfish for me, but for each of you, you know, gotcha. These are the types of opportunities that rarely come along in our industry. And when they start to happen at the very beginning like this, and in a forum like this, we're able to invite you and tell you about it, and you're able to get involved, I would highly encourage you to do so. It's extremely valuable in anybody's career going forward. So I just want to give a big shout out to Craig and say thank you for hanging out with us.
No problem. And anyone who wants to reach out to me, actually, I'm just going to go ahead and type it in the, I may regret this, but I'm going to type it in the chat box. That's my email address, personal email address. If you have any questions about learning engineering, you can reach out to me. And we can do stuff. Marco, I look forward to seeing you, in one of the groups. But let me know. I'll get you hooked up to the Slack group, and then push you, you know, kind of get you set up with whatever, special interest group you want to do. But if you just have questions or you'd be like, I think this is really dumb. Yeah, I understand that. Let me know.
We take all sorts of dumb.
I think it's a super important thing that we have, somebody at least spearheading, all of these things, because everything else that we, all the other learning opportunities that we have in these various areas tend to be fairly ad hoc and loose. And so being able to bring a lot of this information together in single places, I think will help all of us.
I definitely agree. Well, thanks for having me on, guys. Coffee, instructional design, that's my thing. Thanks.
as this thing starts to progress and grow, we'll have you back and you can give us updates and tell us what's going on.
Sure.
And if anything pops, like really important, just let us know and we'll squeeze you in.
Well, I'm on the Twitters, and you'll hear it first. Oh man, I should have shared the Twitter handle for this group. I'll send you a bunch of information after this.
Perfect.
Yeah. All right, guys.
Yeah. Hey, anything else, Chris, before we go?
No, I think it's been tremendous and really appreciate you joining
us. Sure. Anytime. I'm free to talk about just about anything, although you should probably keep me focused on instructional design. That's best.
Well, we might have to do another titled podcast for non-instructional designers in offices drinking.
Right. Things or just find things to drink. Probably not a good idea.
One later in the afternoon and it'll be
exactly.
Instead of a coffee version.
Right. Instructional designers passed out on couches.
Instructional designers, it's 5 o'clock somewhere.
There you go. Hey, there's the music. That's our cue. We gotta
go.
Thanks, everybody. Great to see you all.